gentleman who was born in England, who came to this country, toured with Charlie Chaplin, and made a name for himself on the stage and in motion pictures, and he's my namesake, so here's a toast to Stan.
To Stan.
Who's going to do the toast today? All right, ladies and gentlemen, gentlemen I have known for a very long time back east. He was a member of another Sons of the Desert tent called the Boston Brats.
And we were.
And so I've known you a long time, Dave.
Going on 30 years.
Going on 30 years.
Yes.
This is Mr. Dave Grime giving the toast to Dave Hardy.
Hey. The sentimental gentleman from Georgia, and he was a gentleman, on and off the screen. God, we love him. Today.
To Babe.
To Babe. Who's doing the toast to Finn?
The one that looks most like him.
Okay. Yo. Well, the gentleman who's doing the toast to Finn has been a member of the Sons of the Desert for over 30 years, 40 years, and he was the Grand Sheik of the Way Out West tent, the Grand Sheik of the Early to Bed tent, and he is also a dear friend, and he is also a co-sheik for this tent. The toast to John Duff. The toast to
John Duff.
To John Duff.
I'll just make this short and sweet to my fellow bald companion, to Finn, a Merry Christmas dome.
To Finn.
All right. The toast to May and Charlie. I know you. I know. Oh, I forgot. They have the specialty toasts. Toast to May and Charlie.
To May and Charlie. To May Bush, who. Now, does Charlie remain ever popular, or do they both remain ever popular? Because in my book, they both remain ever
absolutely.
Popular.
Since when does this become a Montel episode?
The Maybush and Charlie Hall, who remain ever popular, and Charlie Hall is just one of, in my opinion, one of the most underrated of the second bananas. To May and Charlie.
To May and Charlie.
A special toast now to a woman who I introduced him to on film, and he really took the gauntlet and now has, I think it's the largest privately owned collection of... privately owned collection. And he was a Grand Sheik in San Diego, Sapson Sea. And he's the current Grand Sheik of the Sapson Sea. I should have said that.
That's perfectly all right.
And he's also Bob Duncan.
Okay, we'll do a toast to a lady who was not only very talented but very versatile, had four distinct careers, film star, Broadway star, jewelry designer, clothing designer, but she'll always be the sweetheart of the Roach Studio. Toast to the beautiful Martha Sleeper. To Martha.
Martha.
To Martha. All right. And a toast now to somebody who is very special to a lot of us, especially on the Hanukkah season. My friend Mike here was vice president of repertory at Sony. He is responsible largely for saving a lot of motion pictures in his time. And he is also a dear, dear friend and also works very diligently on helping the Cinecon Classic Film Festival get a lot of its great films. Mm-hmm. So the toast to Michael Schlesinger.
Yes, as I do, I'm also the Grand Sheik of the Pass the Gravy tent. And the only member.
And for good reason.
As I do every Hanukkah, I toast the Roach Studios token Jew, my role model, my patronus, Uncle Max, to Max Davidson.
Max Davidson.
Okay. Okay. A special toast right now. And I've asked a few of these gentlemen up here specifically because they know the person that I'm gonna toast. I joined the Sons of the Desert when I was 13 years old. And I joined the Sons of the Desert, I didn't know much about it, but I contacted the corresponding secretary of the founding tent, the one that started in New York. The Sons had been around, 11 years at that point. And it was because of this man that I did join the Sons, because he made it sound great. And I became a friend of his. And We had a 42-year friendship. He helped me get even further involved with the Sons of the Desert, and one of his proudest things was to see, because he told me, I became the Grand Sheik of the Founding Tent, that he was a Grand Sheik of, and he just, it was, he just gave me a big hug. He says, my boy, my boy. This fella has been in my life, and the reason that we are actually here today, believe it or not, is because of him. You're a part of this tent because he brought me into the tent in 76. And he has been in my life and has been a great champion. He brought so many of the Hal Roach performers to the Sons of the Desert. He led it with class and with grace. And the reason why I mention it to you now is that 12 days ago, at the age of 92, Dwayne Swift passed away. 92. We cannot complain. He had a wonderful life. His family, his daughters, they are something very special. I know that, yes, 92 years old, but you have to understand, when you're 13 years old and then, you know, someone who is an adult, older than your own parents, talking to you about, film, Laurel and Hardy, and this is great. It really, he changed my life forever. I can't tell you what it is. I thought that when our friend Bob Bertrude passed away last year, those of you who were here, you know that it was just, that's probably the most difficult thing that I have gone through in a very long time. And for those of you who knew Bob, it's very tough. You open up your heart to people, and they open their heart to you, and you have a great time. And so when Dwayne died 12 days ago, the message went out. I've been talking to his daughters, and they had no regrets. They said he was in good health for most all of his life, but it was time, And yet I'm thinking about him, and I knew we were doing this, and I know that people have paid tribute to him in other tents. I know that he had more friends than anyone I have ever known in my life, because he literally traveled the world through the Sons of the Desert, and everyone knew him. He is to the Sons of the Desert what Jerry was to the Muscular Dystrophy Association, and what Chaplin is to silent film. And I'm not overselling it. John, do you want to say something about that?
Well, this one memory I have about Dwayne was 20 years ago, 1997. The Midnight Patrol tent up in Monterey, they did an Edgar Kennedy Festival weekend. Yeah. One of the events they did was a Laurels versus the Hardy softball game. And so depending on your period, that's what team you played on. So Dwayne and several of us were on the Laurels. Dwayne at the time was 72 years old, playing first base. And if you know anything about baseball, that's a pretty active position. Mm-hmm. Dwayne was putting all of us kids in our 40s back then to shame. I'm hoping if I make it to 72, if I get out of bed and find my glasses, that would be enough for me. But Dwayne was amazing back then. So.
John?
I met him just once. And I think he's one of the kindest, most knowledgeable. Is something you kind of forget. And his knowledge of history of Stan and Dave in the Hal Roach Studios is remarkable. And I never saw him without a smile. Ever.
I never heard him yell, Dave.
Yep.
In any organization, there are very few individuals whose footprint is so large that it's virtually incalculable to cover everything that he touched within this organization. That's what I said on my Facebook page when the night I found out he passed. We are family because of him.
Mr. Duncan?
Well, I'll tell the story about way back when I was Grand Sheik out in San Diego. We did an event over in Catalina Island in 1990 in celebration of Stan Long's 100th birthday. Kent did this in coordinate in conjunction with Tony and Lois, and I had not met Dwayne Smith. I knew who he was, but he came out for that event, and we sat down and talked, and it was like we'd known each other 100 years. And he was very supportive of what we were doing down there, and he made what I was trying to do go much smoother, and I've always appreciated the fact that he so supportive of what we were doing.
This is another dear friend who knew him, Nick Santa Maria.
Hi. I just wanted to say that when I was 15, my friends and I we loved the old comedians, you know, Abbott and Costello, Martin and Lewis, Biffle and Schuster, all the great comedy teams. And Laurel and Hardy held a special place in our hearts. And one day, I got the idea, and this was very, very bold for a little kid on Long Island, to write to the head of the New York Sons of the Desert and try to wangle an invitation to one of the meetings. And you have to understand that I didn't do this kind of thing. It just wasn't something I did. I mailed the letter, and I would say about 4 days later, I got a letter back from Dwayne Smith. And it was one of the nicest letters I ever received from anyone in, you know, any aspect of the business. He invited me and my two friends. He made sure we got there okay. Once we got there into the city, he took us on and introduced us to everyone, some of the people we recognized, some of the people we didn't. I just remember that everybody drank a lot. And we were 15 watching everybody drink, you know? And everybody got drunker and drunker. And I remember Liberty, Birthmarks, and Bohemian Girl were the movies they showed. And Dwayne made sure we got home okay. And I will never forget him, ever. Because that's decent. He was a decent, kind human being, and I'll never forget him. Here's to Dwayne Smith.
In 2002, at the Nashville convention, we had, it has never happened before or since, but we had a roast, and it was a roast for Dwayne Smith. I was asked to be the roast master, and it was a wonderful evening. You were there for that, I believe. You were there in Nashville? You were there, I'm sorry. And
there was a free meal.
When it was all over, Dwayne came up to me and he said, I couldn't have wanted or asked for anyone in the world but you to host this. And I said to him, well, I know that Al Kilgore, who was there at the beginning of the Sons of the Desert, who were friends, he would have been a great roast master, because Al was legendary for that. And Dwayne grabbed my shoulders and said, Stan, no one in the world I would have wanted to do it than you. When I turned 55 last Wednesday, I received a Facebook Memories. You know they do that to you? And it was Dwayne wishing me happy birthday. And I was just, wow. Gee, can you believe that? That there it was. In 1978, when the very first Sons convention was happening, and my mom, you can't go to Chicago. Dwayne had called and said, listen, we're going to charter a bus, and I'm going to go. And I'd be able to go. And my mother said, you are going to get on a bus going to Chicago with a man I've never met named Dwayne. Over my dead body. So we've taken a little time here because I realized that while none of you here have met Dwayne Smith, maybe one or two, but those of us who had him in our lives, especially me, I wanted you to understand he really is the father. He is, for me, he's like the George Washington. And so I wanted you to understand how his loss, yes, 92, but you know what? The fact that he passed here, he's one of the people I can actually say that the world is better because he was here. And as we continue on through the years, it's the same thing, My friend Bob Bertrand will live forever as long as, we're doing Cinecon, that keeps him alive. And the fact that we do Sons of the Desert, Dwayne Smith, and he wasn't an actor, but you know what? He just loved this. So I give a toast with my friends here to the man who really made the Sons of the Desert what it really is today and why it is so successful. So I miss you. I love you, Dwayne. And we're going to keep the candle burning to Dwayne Smith. Yeah. All right. Well.